Start webinar, webinar live.
Okay, the webinar is now recording to the audience. So the audience is in. So if everybody wants to go ahead and turn off your screen.
Okay, now I can go live to on Facebook.
Mary Beth, can you hear Malin?
Can you hear me?
I heard you, May.
Check, check. Can anybody hear me?
Yep.
Okay, great.
I hear you. Do you hear me?
Okay. Wait a minute.
Yes.
We are live in 5, 4, 3.
listening? Are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight. We're happy tonight. Walking in a winter wonderland.
Gone away is the bluebird. Here to stay is the new bird.
He sings a love song as we go along, walking in a winter wonderland.
In the meadow we can build a snowman and pretend that he is Parson Brown.
He'll say, are you married? We'll say, no man.
No man.
While you're in town.
Later on, we'll conspire as we dream by the fire
to face unafraid the plans that we made, walking in a winter wonderland. Chillin', we'll frolic and play the Eskimo way. Walking in a winter
Thank you. Thank you. sleigh bells ring. Are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight. We're happy tonight, walking in a winter wonderland.
Gone away is the bluebird. Here to stay is the new bird.
He sings a love song as we go along, walking in a winter wonderland.
In the meadow we can build a snowman and pretend that he is Parson Brown.
We'll say, are you married? We'll say, no man.
No man.
You can do the job while you're in town.
Later on, we'll conspire as we dream by the fire.
To face unafraid the plans that we made, walking in a winter wonderland. Snows, ain't it thrilling? Though your nose gets a chilling, we'll frolic and play the Eskimo way.
Good evening and welcome to the Center for the Arts of Greater Lapeer virtual theater presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. This program is possible with grants from the Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs, the National Endowment for the Arts, and support from the City of Lapeer, Lapeer Main Street DDA, and gifts from our sponsors and patrons. Ladies and gentlemen, It's a Wonderful Life.
We are live in 5, 4, 3, 2.
WBFR in New York City.
This is WBFR, Playhouse of the Air. Good evening, ladies, gentlemen. Greetings from WBFR Studio A in Manhattan, New York. Right here in the U.S. of A. I'm your host, Frida Fillmore, and it's my pleasure to bring you your favorite stories this and every week on WBFR Playhouse of the Air. Tonight, we bring you a real feel-good, heartwarmer, perfect for this or any Christmas Eve. It's A Wonderful Life. We begin our story in the little town of Bedford Hall Falls, New York, where a number of people in town are praying for their dear friend, a typical American named George Bailey.
Dear God, please look over my husband, George.
George is a good boy. You know that. My son has always gone out of his way to give others a hand. Now it's him who needs help.
Oh, my big brother, George. He's done so much for all of us, more for me than I remember.
I remember all the times he would stay after work and not ask for a cent. The world needs more like George Bailey.
George Bailey never thinks about himself. I wouldn't have a roof over my head if it wasn't for him.
If it wasn't for him, I would have given up long ago. All I think about is myself. I must have taken the last cent he had.
The voices carry heavenward. And Josephine, the superintendent of angels, summons Clarence, an apprentice angel.
Oh, you sent for me, ma'am?
Yes, Clarence. A man down on Earth needs our help.
Splendid. Is he sick?
No worse. He's discouraged. At exactly 10:45 p.m. tonight, Earth time, that man will be thinking seriously of throwing away God's greatest gift.
Oh dear, his life? Then I've only a half hour to dress. What are they wearing now?
Oh, you will spend that half hour getting acquainted with George Bailey.
Ma'am, if I should accomplish this mission, might I perhaps win my wings? You know, I've been waiting over 200 years now, and people are beginning to talk.
What's that book you've got with you?
The Adventures of Tom Sawyer, ma'am.
Ah, well, you do a good job with George Bailey, and we'll see about your wings.
Thank you.
If you're going to help George, you'll want to know a little something about him. Look. See the town?
Why, yes. A group of young boys sledding down a snow-covered hill and onto the ice.
Woo! Yes, this is great.
Now, who's that?
That's George Bailey when he was 12, back in 1919. Something happens here. You'll have to remember later on.
Here comes a scare baby. My kid brother, Harry Bailey.
I'm not as scared.
Come on, Harry.
Hey, Harry.
Yippee!
Oh!
Harry's falling through the ice.
I'm coming, Harry. Make a chain, gang.
His brother fell through the ice, and George saved him.
But the icy water gave George a bad ear. It was weeks before he could return to his after-school job at Old Man Gower's drugstore.
It's me, Mr. Gower, George Bailey.
You're late.
2 cents worth of shoelaces, Violet.
Please, Georgie. I like him.
You like every boy.
What's wrong with that?
Here you are.
Bye, Georgie. See you later, Mary.
Made up your mind yet, Mary?
I'll take chocolate.
With coconuts?
I don't like coconuts.
You don't like coconuts? Say, brainless, don't you know where coconuts come from? Look at here, from Tahiti, Fiji Islands, the Coral Sea.
Is that a new magazine? I've never saw it before.
Of course you never. Only us explorers can get it. I've been nominated for membership in the National Geographic Society. Let me get your ice cream.
The day I die.
I'm going exploring someday. Wait and see.
George, you're not paid to be a canary.
Goodbye, George.
Goodbye, Mary.
Now, what was that piece of paper George just picked up?
Telegram for Mr. Gower. He found out this morning that his son died of influenza, and he spent this afternoon drowning his grief in whiskey.
Mr. Gower, do you need anything?
No.
I'll get them, sir.
Take those capsules over to Mrs. Blaine's.
They have the diphtheria there, haven't they?
Get going.
Yes, sir. Mr. Gower, that bottle you used, you put something wrong in those capsules.
Who do you think you are talking to?
Ow. Ow. You're hurting my sore ear.
Did you hear what I said? Get out of here.
Mr. Gower, you don't know what you're doing. You put something wrong in those capsules. I know you got that telegram, and you're upset. But look at the bottle you used, Mr. Gower. It's poison.
Poison?
Don't hit my sore ear again.
Poison. Oh, George. George.
All I wanted was to make sure, Mr. Gower. I won't ever tell a soul. Hope to die, I won't.
Did he ever tell anyone about those pills?
Not a soul.
Did he ever marry the girl? Did he ever go exploring?
We'll get there soon enough, Clarence. George grew up and wanted to go to college, but there just wasn't the money. So he worked for the Building and Loan Association.
Building and Loan Association?
George's father was in the building and loan business, along with George's uncle Billy.
George, what's the combination to the safe?
We wrote it down so you wouldn't forget it.
That's right. Where?
Who's that?
That's Harry F. Potter, the richest and meanest man in all the county.
Peter, Potter's here.
Mr. Bailey, there is nothing quite so loathsome as a family business. Now, Peter, you know what I'm here for. I'm on a very tight schedule, a family to evict at 3.
Okay then, Mr. Potter. Here's the thing. I just need a little more time. I'll dig up that $5,000 somehow.
Have you put any pressure on those people of yours to pay their mortgages?
Times are hard, Mr. Potter. A lot of people are out of work.
Then foreclose.
I can't do that. These families have children.
Are you running a business or a charity ward?
Mr. Potter, what makes you such a hard-skulled character? You have no family, no children. You can't begin to spend all the money you've got.
Oh, so I suppose I should just give it to miserable failures like you and that idiot brother of yours to spend for me.
You can't call my father a failure.
All right, son. Thanks.
Don't let him say that about you, Pop.
What kind of business are you running here?
George worked and saved enough to see him through the university. But first, he was going to Europe. Old man Gower surprised him with the gift of a great big suitcase. On his way home from the store, he ran into his friends Ernie the cab driver and Bert the cop.
Hey, Ernie.
Hiya, George.
Hi, Bert. I'm a rich tourist today. How about driving me home in style?
Sure, Your Highness. Hop in the cab. And for the carriage trade, I puts on my hat.
Good afternoon, Mr. Bailey. Looks like you're ready to get out of here.
Hello, Violet. Hey, you look good. That's some dress you got there.
Oh, this old thing? Why only wear it when I don't care how I look? See you later.
Want to come along, Bert? We'll show you the town.
Family man.
That evening, George had dinner with his father.
Boy, my last supper in the Bailey boarding house.
We're sure gonna miss you, George. I wish we could send Harry to college with you.
Oh, we have that all figured out. Harry will take my job at the building and loan 4 years from now, and then he'll go.
He's pretty young for that job.
Oh, no younger than I was.
You were born older, George. I suppose you've decided what you're going to do when you get out of college.
What I've always talked about, building things, design new buildings, plan modern cities.
You know, it's just a hope. But you wouldn't consider coming back to the building and loan, would you? I know it's early to talk about it.
Oh, I couldn't face being cooped up for the rest of my life in that shabby little office. Oh, I'm sorry, Pop. I didn't mean that remark, but this business of spending your life trying to figure out how to save 3 cents on a length of pipe, I'd go crazy. I want to do something big and important.
You know, George, I feel that in a small way, we are doing something important. It's not too much for a man to want his own roof and walls and fireplace, and we're helping him get those things in our shabby little office.
I know, Dad, but most of my friends have already finished college, and I just feel like if I don't go away, I'll burst.
You're right, son. This town's no place to live if you aren't willing to crawl to Potter. Get your education, then get out of here.
I'm glad you see what I'm talking about. Hey, say maybe I'll go say goodbye to Main Street. Last night in town and all.
Have a good time, son.
Hello, Georgie Porgy.
Hello, Vi.
Where are you going?
I'll probably end up at the library.
Don't you ever get tired of just reading about things?
Yeah. What are you doing tonight?
Not a thing, Georgie.
Are you game, Vi? What do you say we make a night of it?
Oh, I'd love it, Georgie. What do we do?
Let's go out in the fields and take off our shoes and walk in the grass.
Huh?
Then we'll go up to Stewart Lake. It's beautiful up there in the moonlight, and we can swim. Then we can climb Mount Bedford and smell the pines, watch the sunrise against the peaks, and we'll stay up there the whole night, and everybody will be talking about it. There'll be a terrific scandal.
George, have you gone crazy? Walk in the grass in my bare feet? Why, it's 10 miles up there to Mount Bedford. You think just because you... Oh!
Okay. Just forget about the whole thing.
Hee-haw! Forget about what, George?
Oh, nothing, Sam.
Hey, you remember Mary, don't you?
Hi, George.
Hi, Mary.
You wouldn't mind walking Mary home, would you?
Of course not. If that's okay with you, Mary.
It's fine by me.
Great. Thanks. Hee-haw!
George walks Mary home. Is that important, Josephine?
I'd say it is. Because even though Mary lived only 4 blocks away, it took them 2 hours to get there.
Buffalo gals, won't you come out tonight? Come out tonight, come out tonight. Buffalo girls, won't you come out tonight?
And dance by the light of the moon.
Dog, oh boy. Just like an organ, gee whiz.
Beautiful.
You know something? If it wasn't me talking, I'd say you were the prettiest girl in town.
Well, why don't you say it?
I don't know, maybe I will. Hey. Look where we are.
Oh, the old Granville house.
Yeah. I gotta throw a rock.
Oh, no, don't. I love that old house.
Well, don't you know about deserted houses? You make a wish and then you throw a rock.
But, George, it's such a lovely old place. I wish I lived there.
I wouldn't live there if I was a ghost. Now watch this. Pretty good shot, huh? Broke a window.
What's your wish, George?
Not one wish. A whole hatful, Mary. I'm shaking the dust of this crummy little town off of my feet, and I'm going to see the world. Italy, Greece, the Parthenon, the Colosseum. And then I'm coming back here, and I'm going to go to college and see what they know. And then I'm going back to build airfields and skyscrapers 100 stories high and bridges a mile long. Well, hey, what? Are you going to throw a rock too? Hey, that was pretty good. What'd you wish for, Mary?
Oh, no. If I tell you, it may not come true.
What do you want, Mary? Do you want the moon? All you got to do is just say the word and I'll throw a lasso around it and I'll pull it down.
Okay, I'll take it. And then what?
Well, then you could swallow it and it all dissolves, see? And the moonbeams would shoot out of your fingers and your toes and the ends of your hair and the... Am I talking too much?
Yes! Why don't you kiss her instead of talking her to death?
Who's that?
It's old man Collins on his front porch.
Youth is wasted on their own people.
Hey, mister, come back out here and I'll show you some kissing that'll put hair back on your head.
George!
Uncle Billy?
George, get in the car quick. Your father's had a stroke.
I'm sorry. I've got to go, Mary.
George's father died that night, Clarence. So George couldn't go to Europe. That fall, just as he was running ready to leave for college, the directors of the building and loan held a meeting. They were going to appoint a successor.
Always trouble.
I want the board to know that George gave up his trip to Europe to help straighten things out here these past few months, and it was greatly appreciated. I think we all need, that's all we're going to need from you, George. Good luck to you at school. I know you're anxious to make a train.
Yes, I have a taxi waiting downstairs.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to get to my real purpose. I claim this institution is not necessary to this town. Therefore, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to dissolve the building and loan.
That's ridiculous.
It's too soon after Peter Bailey's death to discuss chloroform in the building and loan. His faith and devotion are responsible for this organization.
I'll go further than that. I'll say Peter Bailey was the building and loan.
Oh, that's fine, Potter, coming from you, considering you're the one who drove him to his grave.
Peter Bailey was not a businessman. That's what killed him. He was a man with high ideals, without common sense. And what does that get us but a discontented, lazy rabble instead of a thrifty working class? All because a few starry-eyed dreamers like Peter Bailey stir them up and fill their heads with a lot of impossible hooey. Now I say...
Just a minute, Mr. Potter. You're right when you say my father was no businessman. Why he ever started this building and loan, I'll never know, but you can't say anything against this character. Why, in the 25 years since he and Uncle Billy started this thing, he never once thought of himself. But he did help a few people get out of your slums, Mr. Potter. And just remember that this rabble you're talking about do most of the working and paying and living and dying in this community. Well, is it too much for them to have a place to live and die with a couple of decent rooms and a bath? My father didn't think so. People were human beings to him. But to you, a warped, frustrated old man, they're cattle. In my book, he died a much richer man than you'll ever be.
I'm not interested in your book.
Well, I've said too much. You're the board. You do what you want with this thing. But remember that this town needs this measly one-horse institution, if only to have some place where people can come without crawling the Potter here. Come on, Uncle Billy.
Sentimental hogwash. I want my motion.
Just coming out of the board meeting. I'll have to call you back. What happened, George? All we heard was yelling.
Oh, boy, Matilda, you should have heard George.
Yeah, they're voting us down in there.
They're putting us out of business. So what? I can get another job. I'm only 52.
You're 58.
George, they voted Potter down.
Whoopee! We're still in business!
Under one condition, that you take your father's place, George.
Oh, I'm going to college. Uncle Billy here, he's your man.
You can keep him on. That's all right.
I'm going to school. This is my last chance.
But they'll vote with Potter otherwise.
So George Bailey didn't go to college.
That's right, Clarence. He gave up his college money to his brother instead and waited 4 years for Harry to come back and take over the building and loan. Then he could still see the world.
There she blows. Say, Uncle Billy, you know what the three most wonderful sounds on earth are?
Yep. Breakfast is served, lunch is served, and dinner is served.
Anchor chains, plane motors, and train whistles. Hey, here's the professor now.
Well, if it isn't George Geographic Explorer Bailey. Uncle Billy, you haven't changed a bit.
Well, am I glad to see you.
Where's Mother?
Oh, she's home cooking a fatted calf. Now, come on, let's go.
Oh, wait. This is Ruth Dakin.
Ruth Dakin Bailey, if you don't mind.
I wired you. I had a surprise. Here she is, Lisa White.
Well, what do you know? Wife!
Congratulations, Harry. Why didn't you tell somebody? What's a pretty girl like you doing marrying this two-headed brother of mine?
It's purely mercenary. My father offered him a job.
Oh, he gets you? And a job? Harry's cup runneth over. Come on, Ruth. Let's start ahead and lead the bags for the fellas.
All right.
George, about that job. I never said I'd take it. You've been holding the bag here for 4 years. I won't let you down.
That night, the homecoming for Harry became his wedding party. Uncle Billy familiarized himself with the spirits.
Oh boy, I feel so good. I could spit in Potter's eye. I think I will. What do you say? Maybe I should go home. If you don't mind, point me in the right direction.
Right down there.
That way? All right, old building and loan pal. See you later. I'm all right.
George?
Out here on the porch, Mother.
Well, how do you like your new sister-in-law?
She's swell.
Looks like she'll keep Harry on his toes.
Yeah, keep him out of Bedford Falls anyway.
George, do you know Mary Hatch is back from school?
Yeah?
Nice girl, Mary. The kind who will help you find all answers.
Uh-huh.
Give me one good reason you shouldn't call on her.
Well, Sam Wainwright. Sam's crazy about her.
Well, she's not crazy about him.
How do you know that? Did she discuss it with you?
No, besides, Sam's in New York, and you're here in Bedford Falls.
And all's fair in love and war, huh?
I don't know about war.
All right, Mother. I think I'll go out and find the girl and do a little passionate necking.
Oh, George.
Bye, Mrs. Bailey. By the way, do you want any books from the library?
The library? George, you go and see Mary, you hear?
Hello, George.
Hello, Mary. I just happened to be passing by.
Your mother just phoned and said you were on your way.
My mother just called you? How did she know? I just went for a walk and happened to be passing by. When did you get back?
Tuesday. Would you like to come in?
Well, I guess, since I'm here. Say, where'd you get that dress?
Do you like it?
It's all right. I thought you'd go back to New York with Sam and the rest of them.
Oh, I worked there a couple of vacations, but I don't know. I guess I was homesick.
Homesick for Bedford Falls?
Well, yes. And my family and, oh, everything.
Still can't understand it, though. I didn't tell anybody I was coming here.
Well, would you rather leave?
Well, I don't want to be rude.
It was nice about Harry and Ruth, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, that's all right.
Well, don't you like her?
Well, of course I like her. She's a peach.
So it's just marriage in general you're not enthusiastic about?
No. Marriage is okay for Harry and Sam and you.
Mary? Who are you talking to?
It's George Bailey, Mother.
George Bailey? What does he want?
I don't know. What do you want, George?
Me? Not a thing. I just came in to get warm.
He's making violent love to me, Mother.
You tell him to go right back home. Sam Wainwright promised to call from New York tonight, didn't he?
Your mother needn't. I didn't come here to...
What did you come here for?
Well, you're supposed to be the one with all the answers. You tell me.
Why don't you go home?
That's where I'm going.
Mary, the telephone, it's Sam.
I'll get it. Yeehaw. Hello, Sam. How are you?
Oh, great. It's good to hear your voice again.
Oh, well, that's awfully sweet of you, Sam. There's an old friend of yours here, George Bailey.
You mean old Mossback George? Yeehaw, put him on.
Wait a minute, I'll call him. George?
He doesn't want to speak to George.
He asked for him. George, Sam wants to speak to you.
Hello, Sam.
Hey, a fine pal you are. You trying to steal my girl?
Nobody's trying to steal your girl.
Hey, I want to talk to both of you. Tell Mary to get on the extension.
Mother's on the extension.
I am not.
We can both hear you. George, put your head a little closer.
Okay.
There, that's better. We're listening, Sam.
I have a big deal coming up that's going to make us all rich. George, do you remember that night at Martini's Bar when you told me about making plastics out of soybeans?
Huh? Oh, yes, soybeans.
Well, my father's checked into it and wants to build a factory outside of Rochester. How do you like that?
Why Rochester?
Why not? Can you think of anything better?
Well, why not right here in Bedford Falls? You remember that old tool and machinery works? You tell your father he can get that for a song and all the labor he wants, too. Half the town was thrown out of work when they closed down.
That's so. Well, that sounds great. Now, here's the point, George. I may have a job for you. That is, unless you're still married to that old broken-down building and loan. Mary?
I'm here.
Tell that guy I'm giving him the chance of a lifetime.
He says it's the chance of a lifetime.
Give me that phone. Now, you listen to me, Mary. I don't want any plastics, and I don't want any job, and I don't want to get married, ever, to anyone. Do you understand that? I want to do what I want to do, and you're not going to... Oh, Mary.
George.
Oh, Mary, I love you.
George, I love you, too.
George and Mary were married. And following the wedding and reception, George's old pal Ernie, the cab driver, drove the happy couple to the train station.
So, where are you two off to on this here honeymoon?
We're going to shoot the works. A whole week in New York, then Bermuda. The highest hotels, the oldest champagne, the richest caviar, the hottest music, and the prettiest wife.
Here's the kitty, Ernie. $2,000. I feel like a bootlegger's wife.
Finally getting out of Bedford Falls then, huh? Then what?
Yeah, then what, honey?
After that, who cares?
Hey, George, there's something funny going on over there. Look over there at the bank. Looks like a run to me.
Pull over a minute, will you, Ernie?
Oh, George, let's not stop. Please, let's go straight to the station.
Well, wait a minute. I better see what it is. I'll be right back.
I want my money. Let me in.
Where's my money?
Come on. Where's
my money? I want it.
Where's my money?
Hold on. What is this, Uncle Billy? A holiday? Why are the doors locked? There's a crowd out front. Let them in.
This is a pickle, George.
What happened?
The bank called our loan. I had to hand out all our cash.
All of it?
Every last cent of it.
Holy mackerel.
And then I got scared, George.
Open the doors. Let them in.
All right. Come on. Where's our money, George? Keep my money now.
Now, just remember, this thing isn't as black as it appears.
Where's our money, George?
You're thinking of this place all wrong. The money's not here. Your money's in people's houses, in the Kennedy house, in the McLaren house, and 100 others. Now, what are you going to do? Foreclose on them?
I got $242 in here, and $242 isn't going to break anybody.
All right, Charlene, you'll get your money in 60 days.
60 days?
That's what you agreed to when you bought your shares.
I got my money. Old Man Potter's taking over the bank. He'll pay you 50 cents on the dollar.
Yeah.
50 cents. Hey, 50 cents on the dollar. That's amazing.
If Potter gets a hold of your shares, he'll own this building alone. He's got the bank, he's got the bus line, he's got the department stores, and now he's after us because he wants to keep you living in his shacks and paying the kind of rent he decides to charge. Now, we can get through this all right, but we've got to have faith in each other.
My husband's out of work. We need the money.
I've got doctor's bills to pay.
How much do you need? We've got $2,000 from the wedding.
Hey, Mary, I've got $2,000 right here. This'll tide us over till the bank reopens. All right, Charlene, how much do you need?
$242.
Ah, Charlene, just enough to tide you over.
I'll take $242.
Okay, Uncle Billy, give Charlene $242. All right, Edna, how much now just to get by?
$20, I suppose.
Now we're talking. Mrs. Thompson, how about you?
But it's your own money, George.
Well, never mind that. How much, Mrs. Thompson?
Could I have $17.50?
Bless your heart, of course you can have it. Uncle Billy, give her $17.50. Pay it back when you can, all right? Who's next?
Look at the clock. Look!
5 seconds, 4 seconds, 3, 2, 1, 6 o'clock, we made it. Lock that door, Uncle Billy. We're still in business.
Bailey Brothers building at, just a minute. George, there's a phone call for you.
Look, will you get my wife on the phone? She's probably over at her mother's.
Mrs. Bailey is on the phone.
I don't want Mrs. Bailey. I want my wife. Oh, Mrs. Bailey, that's my wife. Mary? Hello? Oh, listen, dear. I'm sorry. What? Come home. What home? 320 Sycamore. Well, what? Whose home is that? The Waldorf Hotel, huh?
That doesn't look like the home.
Oh, no. Number 320 Sycamore was the old Granville house. The one George and Mary threw rocks at and made wishes. Mary had prepared the house, including a turkey dinner, romantic decorations, and even a marriage bed.
Welcome home, Mr. Bailey.
Well, I'll be.
Remember the night we broke the windows in this old house? This is what I wish.
Darling, you're wonderful.
Yes, sir. That's where they spent their honeymoon. That's where they started their lives together. Mary made the leaky old house a home, and George toiled away at the building and loan office.
Oh, gee, Mary Hatch, why in the world would you ever marry a guy like me anyway?
To keep from being an old maid.
I was going to give you the moon, but what have I given you? Not even a new dress, not for months. You could have married Sam Wainwright, anybody else in town.
I didn't want to marry anybody else in town. I want my baby to look like you.
You didn't even have a honeymoon, I promised you. You're what?
My baby.
You mean, Mary, you're on the nest?
George Bailey lassoes the stork.
Well, Mary had her baby. A boy.
You don't say.
Then she had a girl. Night after night, George would come home late from the office. Things weren't good with the building and loan. Potter was bearing down hard. Then came the war. Mary had another baby by then, but still had time to run the USO. Gower and Uncle Billy sold war bands. Violet entertained the troops. Bert the Cop was wounded in North Africa and got the Silver Star. Ernie, the taxi driver, parachuted into France. But Harry Bailey topped them all. A Navy flyer, he shot down 15 planes. Two of them as they were about to crash into a transport full of soldiers.
But what about George?
4F on account of his ear. George fought the Battle of Bedford Falls, air raid warden, paper drives, scrap drives, rubber drives. On VE Day, he wept and prayed. VJ Day, he wept and prayed again.
We're getting pretty close to today, aren't we?
Yes, Clarence. You know now almost everything you have to know about George Bailey, except what happened that finds him down there at this moment wanting to die. Today's the day before Christmas, and Billy's at the bank to make a deposit when he runs into Potter.
Well, 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 Mr. Henry A.F. Potter, come to the bank to deposit more loot? How do you like the news in the paper, Mr. Potter? Harry Bailey wins the Congressional Medal of Honor.
Let me see that newspaper.
Here you go. Go on and keep it. I'm off to make a deposit.
Good morning, Mr. Bailey.
Good morning, Hortense. Here you are. Deposit slip, bank book, and a very Merry Christmas to you.
You too, Mr. Bailey. You want to make a deposit?
Well, certainly.
Well, it's customary to bring your money with you.
It's gone. Where'd I put it? Where'd I put that money?
A terrible thing, Clarence. Uncle Biddley couldn't find the money because the envelope with the $8,000 was folded up in that newspaper he gave to old man Potter. At the same time, as Billy started looking for the deposit, Violet came to visit George at the building and loan.
Hello, Vi. What's wrong?
You see right through me, don't you?
How much do you need?
I hate doing this to you, George, but I won't be asking for any more after this.
You plan on robbing a bank, Vi?
I'm going to Manhattan.
What's in Manhattan?
Why, everything's in Manhattan. A new start, at least.
That's a big step, Vi. What's the matter with starting a new life right here in Bedford Falls?
Well, I'll be. Never thought I'd hear that from you, George Bailey. I thought you hated this place.
I did, but this town has a sense of charm of its own.
I've made a decision. There's a midnight train tonight, and I plan to be on it.
Takes a lot of character to leave your hometown and start all over again. Here's some dough.
No, George, don't.
Well, what do you want to do, hock your furs in that hat? You want to walk to New York? You know they charge for meals and rent there just the same as they do in Bedford Falls.
Yeah, sure.
It's a loan. That's my business, building and loan. Besides, you'll get a job. Now, good luck to you.
I'm glad I know you, George Bailey. Merry Christmas.
George?
What's the matter, Uncle Billy?
The money, the 8,000, I...
What, Uncle Billy, what happened to it?
I thought I had it. I just don't know what happened.
Well, the first place you look is in your coat pocket. I told you to put it there when you left.
Oh, I'm no good to you, George, no good.
Uncle Billy, we've got to find that money, think.
I can't think anymore, George. It hurts.
Where's the money, you stupid, silly old fool? Do you realize what this means? It means bankruptcy and scandal and prison. One of us is going to go to jail. Well, it's not going to be me.
Hello, Daddy.
Hello, Daddy. Hello, darling. Where's your coat and hat?
Left them at the office.
Isn't it wonderful about Harry? We're famous, George. I'll bet I had 50 calls today about the parade and banquet.
Must she keep playing that?
I have to practice for the party tonight, Daddy.
Mommy says we could stay up until midnight and sing Christmas carols.
Better hurry and shave. The families will be here soon.
Families? I don't want any families over here.
Excuse me.
Did you have a hectic day?
Oh, yeah, another big red-letter day for the Baileys.
Daddy, the Browns next door have a new car. You should see it.
Well, what's the matter with our car? Isn't it good enough for you?
Yes, Daddy.
Excuse me.
Excuse you for what?
I burped.
All right, darling, you're excused. Now go upstairs and see what little Zuzu wants.
What's the matter with Zuzu?
Oh, she caught a cold coming home from school. They gave her a flower and she didn't want to crush it, so she didn't button up her coat. The doctor says it's nothing serious.
Was the doctor here?
I called him right away.
Is she running a temperature?
Just a teensy one.
Gosh, it's this old house. I don't know why we don't all have pneumonia. This drafty old barn might as well be living in a refrigerator. Why did we have to stay and live here in the first place, around this measly, crummy old town?
George, what's wrong?
Everything's wrong. You call this a happy family? Why did we have all these kids?
Dad, how do you spell frankincense?
I don't know. Ask your mother.
Where are you going?
Up to see Zuzu.
Hi, Daddy.
Well, what happened to you?
I want a flower.
Well, where do you think you're going?
I want to give my flower a drink.
Here, give Daddy the flower. I'll give it a drink.
Look, Daddy, some of the petals came off. Paste it.
All right now. There it is. Good as new.
Give the flower a drink.
Now will you try to get some sleep?
I'm not sleepy. I want to look at my flower.
I know, but you just go to sleep, and then you can dream about it, and it'll be a whole garden.
It will?
Telephone!
I'll get it. Hello? Yes, this is Mrs. Bailey. Oh, thank you, Mrs. Welch. The doctor says she'll be out of bed in time for her Christmas dinner.
Is that Zuzu's teacher?
Yes.
Let me speak to her. Hello, Mrs. Welch. This is George Bailey. Say, what kind of a teacher are you anyway? What do you mean sending her home like that half naked?
George!
Is this the sort of thing we pay taxes for, to have teachers like you? Silly, stupid, careless people who send our kids home without any clothes on? Aw, oh, that's stupid.
Hello, Mrs. Welch. I want to apologize. She hung up.
I'll hang her up.
Who do you think you are?
Hello? Who's this? Oh, Mr. Welch. Oh, that's fine, Mr. Welch. Gives me a chance to tell you what I really think of your wife.
George.
Will you let me handle this? Hello? Oh, you will, huh? Okay, Mr. Welch, anytime you think you're man enough. Hello? Huh?
Daddy, how do you spell hallelujah?
Well, what do you think I am, a dictionary? Janie, haven't you learned that silly tune yet? You've played it over and over again. Now stop it. Stop it.
George, what are you doing?
I'm sorry, Mary. Janie, I didn't mean to. You go on and practice. Pete, I owe you an apology, too. What did you want to know?
Nothing, Daddy.
What's the matter with everybody? Janie, go on. I told you to practice. Go on. Play.
Oh, Daddy.
George, why must you torture the children? Why don't you?
Mary.
Bedford 247, please.
Where's Daddy going?
Yes, Pete.
Is Daddy in trouble?
Yes, Pete.
Shall I pray for him?
Yes, Janie. Pray very hard.
Me too?
You too, Tommy. Hello, Uncle Billy?
So that's it, George. You're short $8,000.
I'll pay any sort of interest, Mr. Potter. If you still want the building and loan.
You say it was lost. Did you notify the police?
No, I haven't, with Harry's homecoming tomorrow.
Why come to me? Why not go to Sam Wainwright?
I can't get a hold of him. He's in Europe.
What kind of security would I have, George?
I have a $15,000 life insurance policy.
How much is your equity?
$500.
You want $8,000? You used to be so cocky. You were going to go out and conquer the world. You once called me a warped, frustrated old man. What are you but a warped, frustrated young man? Crawling in here on your hands and knees for help, you're worth more dead than alive.
I'll do anything, Mr. Potter. Please help me.
You know what I'm going to do for you? As a stockholder of the building and loan, I'm calling the state examiner to get a warrant for your arrest. Misappropriation of funds. Manipulation. Malfeasance. Go on and run. You can't hide in a little town like this.
Hey, it's glad you came.
Ooh, these are great.
Oh, man, that's great. I love this food. It's great. Look at this.
I got another drink of lobsters for you.
Oh, Merry Christmas.
Now, where's George, man?
After running out of Potter's office, George ended up at Martini's bar. He's had a couple of drinks, and he's just sitting there.
What's he doing?
Shh.
Dear Father in Heaven, I'm not a praying man, but if you're up there and you can hear me, show me the way.
You all right, George?
Why you drinking so much, my friend? You don't feel good? Please, go home.
Bailey? Which Bailey?
This gentleman is Mr. George Bailey.
George Bailey, huh?
Oh!
The next time you talk to my wife like that, you'll get worse. It isn't enough. She slaves over your stupid kids, teaching them how to read and write. You have to bawl her out.
You get out of here, Mr. Welch. You hit my best friend.
All right.
Mr. Bailey, you okay?
Who is that?
Mr. Welch, but don't worry. He don't come to this place no more. I'll get you something to your face.
I'm all right.
Oh, please, don't go away, Mr. Bailey. Please don't.
George is heading to the bridge row, Clarence. Can you see him?
He looks like he's gonna jump.
It's time, Clarence!
Help! Help me, I can't swim.
Hold it, mister! I'm coming!
What the hell are the two of you doing? Now get out of that water. Are you two all right? You need a doctor?
I'm all right.
I'm fine. Well, this underwear, I didn't have time to get anything stylish. You know, my wife gave me this on my last birthday. I passed away in it.
Passed away?
Oh, I see. Tom Sawyer is drying out too.
Who?
My book. I left in such a hurry. I brought Tom Sawyer with me. You know, you should read the new book Mark Twain is working on.
How'd you happen to fall in?
I jumped in so you wouldn't go through with it.
Go through with what?
Suicide.
Suicide's against the law around here.
And it's against the law where I come from, too.
Where do you come from?
Heaven.
What?
I had to act quickly. That's why I jumped in. I knew if I were drowning, you would try to save me. And you did. And that's how I saved you.
Very funny.
Your lip's bleeding, George.
I got busted in the jaw in an answer to a prayer.
Oh, no, George. I'm the answer to your prayer.
Say, how do you know my name?
I know all about you.
Well, what are you, a mind reader or something?
Oh, no. My name's Clarence Oddbody, AS2.
Oddbody, AS2. What's the AS2?
Angel Second Class.
What? You may not need a doctor, but I do.
Cheerio, my good man.
Hey, look here. Why'd you want to save me?
Because I'm your guardian angel.
I wouldn't be a bit surprised.
Ridiculous of you to think of killing yourself for $8,000.
How do you know about things like that?
I'm your guardian angel.
Well, you look like about the kind of angel I'd have. Sort of a fallen angel, aren't you? Say, what happened to your wings?
I haven't won my wings yet. That's why I'm an angel second class. But you can help me earn them by letting me help you.
You don't happen to have 8,000 bucks on you, do you?
Oh, no. We don't use money in heaven.
That comes in pretty handy down here, bub. I found it out a little late. I'm worth more dead than alive.
I won't get my wings with that attitude. You just don't know all that you've done. If it hadn't been for you...
Hadn't been for me, everybody'd be a lot better off. My wife and my kids and my friends.
This isn't going to be easy.
They'd all be better off if I hadn't been born.
What did you say?
I said I wish I'd never been born.
Oh, George, that's wonderful.
Wonderful.
The idea you just gave me, that'd do it, okay? There. You've got your wish. You've never been born.
Never been born?
Exactly. No worries, no $8,000 to get, nothing. You simply don't exist.
Wait a minute. Say something else in this ear of mine.
That's right. You can hear out of it. Don't you see you're a... Well, you're nobody.
Well, that's the doggonest thing.
Your lips stopped bleeding too, George.
What do you know? What happened? I need a drink. What about you, Angel? Do you want a drink?
I don't know.
Come on, we'll go as soon as our clothes are dry.
Our clothes are dry.
That still was hotter than I thought. Well, look, let's get dressed and we'll stroll over to Martini's and... Oh, excuse me, I'll stroll. You'll fly.
I haven't got my wings.
Hey, what do you got to do here? Come on, Marky.
There's a place to sit down. Welcome to the best bar in Bedford Falls.
Bedford Falls? Don't you mean Pottersville?
Pottersville? Hey, where's Martini, your boss?
Look, I'm the boss. You want a drink or don't you?
Okay, all right. Double bourbon. Quick, okay?
What's yours, bub?
I was just thinking of mulled wine. Heavy on the cinnamon, light on the curry.
Look, mister, we serve hard drinks in here for men who want to get drunk fast. We don't need any characters around here given the joint atmosphere.
Just give him the same as I ordered. He's okay.
Two double bourbon.
What is it about this place? It seems to have changed.
All of Bedford Falls has changed. You're having your wish, George. You've never been born. There'll be lots of things you've never seen before. Oh, good. Somebody just made it. Every time you hear a bell ring, it means that some angel just got his wings.
What did you say?
Clarence, you better not talk about angels in here.
Don't they believe in angels?
Well, maybe they believe in them, but you know...
So why should they be surprised when they see one?
Don't mind him, Nick. He never grew up. How old are you anyway, Clarence?
293 next May.
That does it! Out, you two pixies, go! Through the door or out the window! Well... Look who crawled in from wherever the hole he is that he's been hiding in.
Hey, it's Mr. Gower.
Didn't I tell you never to come panhandling around here no more?
Mr. Gower, it's George Bailey. Don't you know me?
Buy me a drink, mister. Just one drink, mister.
Binky! Cole, come here and throw the roomie out.
You got it.
Hey, Nick, isn't that Mr. Gower, the druggist?
That rum had spent 20 years in jail for poisoning some kid. If you know him, you must be a jailbird yourself. Binky, here's two more. Get him out of here.
You got it, boss.
Serves him right.
What's wrong with Mr. Gower?
He doesn't know you, George, and you weren't there to stop him from putting the poison into that prescription.
What do you mean I wasn't there? What are you, a hypnotist? Why am I seeing all these strange things here?
It's because you were never born.
Then if I wasn't born, who am I?
Nobody. You have no identity.
What do you mean? My name's George Bailey.
There is no George Bailey. You have no papers, no cards, no driver's license, no 4F card, no insurance policy, no...
Zuzu's petals. My little girl, some petals fell off of her flower. I told her I'd fix it and I stuck them into my pocket, but... Well, they're gone too. Everything's gone.
You've been given a great gift, George. The chance to see what the world would be like without you.
You're as crazy as a bedbug and you're driving me crazy too. Now leave me alone. I'm going home to my wife and family.
You know the drill. Hands behind your back, sister.
Why don't you bust somebody else for a change?
Hey, officer, where did the building and loan move to?
Building and what?
The Bailey building and loan. It was in that building.
They went out of business years ago. Now all that's left is this burlesque house.
Not so fast, Copper. I know Potter.
Hey, Violet. Hey, that's Violet Bick.
Believe me, I know.
I know that girl.
Who doesn't? Now get out of our way.
Taxi! Hey, Ernie! Take me home. I'm going off my nut.
Where do you live, buddy?
Doggone it, Ernie. Don't you start pulling that stuff. You know where I live. 320 Sycamore. Now hurry up.
Okay. 320 Sycamore.
Ernie, straighten me out here. I've had some bad liquor or something, but listen to me. You're Ernie Bishop, and you live in Bailey Park with your wife and kid, right?
You seen my wife?
Seen your wife? I've been to your house 100 times.
Hey, fella, what's the idea? I live in a shack in Potter's Field, and my wife ran away 3 years ago, took the kid, and I ain't never seen you before in my life. Get it?
Okay, just step on it. Just get me home.
Is this the place?
Of course it's the place.
This here house ain't been lived in 20 years.
Mary, Pete, Tommy, Janie, Zuzu, I'm home.
They're not here, George. You have no children.
What have you done with them, Clarence?
All right, put your hands up, both of you. No fast moves.
Bert, thank heavens you're here, Bert. What happened to this house? Where's Mary and my kids?
Come with me. I'm going to take you down to the station.
Bert, listen to me. This fellow here says he's an angel.
Don't make me use my nightstick.
Bert, I hate to do this, but...
Oh, run, George, run!
Ma Bailey's boarding house. Mother?
Mother? What do you want?
Mother, I'm George. I thought for sure you'd remember me.
If you're looking for a room, there's no vacancy.
Mother, please try to understand. Something's happened to me and I need a place to stay. Please let me stay here.
I don't take strangers.
I'm not a stranger. I know everybody you know. Your brother-in-law, Uncle Billy.
When'd you last see him?
Today, over at his house.
That's a lie. He's been in the insane asylum ever since he's lost his business. And if you ask me, that's where you belong.
I'm here again, George.
My own mother didn't even know me.
One man's life touches so many others. When he isn't around, he leaves a pretty big hole, doesn't he?
Look, you. I've heard things like this before. You got me under some kind of spell. Well, I'm going to snap out of it. Now let me think. Bailey Park!
There is no Bailey Park if you weren't here to build it.
We'll see. What's this graveyard doing here where Bailey Park is supposed to be? Look at this gravestone. Why is my brother Harry's name here?
Harry broke through the ice, drowned at age 9.
That's a lie. Harry Bailey went to war. He got the Congressional Medal of Honor. He saved the lives of every man on that transport.
Every man on that transport died. Harry wasn't there to save them because you weren't there to save Harry. You see, George, you really had a wonderful life. Don't you see what a mistake it would be to throw it away?
What happened to Mary, Clarence?
Oh, I'm not supposed to tell you, George.
I don't know how you know the things you do, but please, just let me see her. Where is she?
You're not going to like it, George. She's an old maid.
What? Where is she?
She's just about to close up the library. Man, there must be some easier way to earn my wings.
Is the library closed?
It's Christmas Eve. We can't stay open all night.
Mary, I'm sorry.
How do you know my name?
Please, just 2 minutes. That's all I need.
You sound desperate. I'll help if I can. What is it?
Isn't this town Bedford Falls?
It used to be, but then Potter was elected and renamed the town Pottersville.
Mary Hatch, you live in a white Victorian on Reed Street with your mother, and you have an older brother named Marty.
How do you know all this? Get your hands off me. I'll call a cop.
Don't you know me? You must, Mary. It's George. Oh, don't do this to me. Where are our kids? I need you, Mary.
Get away from me. Help, police.
It's George. Please, Mary, you're my wife.
Stop.
Help me, Clarence. Get me back. I don't care what happens to me. Only get me back to my wife and kids. Help me, Clarence, please. I want to live again. Oh, God, please let me live again.
George! Is that you, George?
Bert, you come any closer and I'll hit you again.
What the Sam Hill are you yelling for, George?
George, Bert, do you know me?
Know you? I've been looking all over town for you.
I'm alive again, Bert!
You sure are. You all right? Your mouth's bleeding.
It is. Hey, my mouth's bleeding! Zuzu's petals. There they are! What do you know about that? Merry Christmas, Bert!
Get in the car. I'll drive you home.
Merry Christmas, Bedford Falls! Hey, Merry Christmas, you wonderful old building alone! Merry Christmas, Mr. Potter!
Merry Christmas, George. Go on home. The sheriff's waiting for you.
So how about that eggnog?
I can't
look at George.
Wow.
Beautiful.
He is such a good guy. I'm so glad I know him. I can't wait to see him.
Mary! Mary, I'm home! Hey, what is this? Merry Christmas, everyone!
George, I got a little paper here.
I'll bet it's a warrant for my arrest. Isn't that wonderful? Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas, Daddy.
Merry Christmas, Daddy.
Kids, Pete, Janie, Tommy, I could eat you up. Where's your mother?
She went looking for you with Uncle Billy.
George, darling, where have you been? Oh, George.
Mary, you're real. You have no idea what's happened.
You have no idea what's happened either. Come on, George, quick. They're on their way.
Who's on their way? The police department, the FBI, the National Guard? Well, let them come. I'm alive again, Mary.
Oh my God.
Now, you stand right over here by the tree and don't move. Looks like George, it's a miracle. Come in, Uncle Billy. Everybody, in here.
It's wonderful. Mary did it, George. She told a few people that you were in trouble, and they scattered all over town collecting money. They didn't ask any questions. They said, if George is in trouble, you can count on me. You'll never see anything like it.
Here you go. $242. Merry Christmas.
And busted the jukebox, too.
Mr. Gower!
I made the rounds on my charge counts.
Violet Bick!
I'm not gonna go, George. I changed my mind.
I've been saving this money for a divorce. If I ever get a husband.
Merry Christmas.
Oh, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Quiet, everybody. Quiet. A telegram from London.
Oh,
Mr. Gower cables, you need cash. Stop. My office instructed to advance you up to $25,000. Stop. Gee-haw! And Merry Christmas, Sam Wainwright.
Harry!
Harry!
Mary, looks like I got here too late. I left as soon as I got Mary's telegram.
How about some wine?
Good idea. A toast. My big brother, George, the richest man in town.
You're here.
Yeah. You're here. Mm-hmm. Hey, George. What's this book, George?
Tom Sawyer.
Look, there's an inscription.
George, remember, no man is a failure who has friends. Thanks for the wings. Love, Clarence.
What's that?
A Christmas present from a very dear friend of mine.
Daddy, teacher says every time a bell rings, an angel gets a twin.
That's right. That's right. Attaboy, Clarence.
This has been WBFR Playhouse of the Air's presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. Stay tuned for a program of popular holiday music, and now, a word from our local sponsors.
Would you like to participate in virtual theater and radio plays like the one you heard tonight? Then the PIX has plenty of opportunities for you. Beginning in the winter of 2021, the PIX will be offering performance opportunities for adults and kids. Watch our website for winter programming. There's something for everyone. Beginners are welcome.
And we want to tell you how honored we are to have you in our audience. Although we can't see you, we can feel you. And this is what makes a community Christmas whole. 2020 has been a hard year for us all. And that's especially time for hard nonprofits. They struggle too, just like the Center for the Arts and the PIX Theater of Greater Lapeer. So help us dig deep and find our roots so that if we have wings to fly in times to come, we will be strong together. Consider giving us a little tip, an operational support, if you would, and text to 44321. So please get out your phones and keep the gallery open. We volunteer, but it keeps our virtual theater alive and thriving. Don't we need this now? Lay a foundation for the doors opening again when we will be together live to celebrate the arts in person. So please text whatever you can. Operational support in 44321. So don't delay. Be our guardian angels today. Please, any amount is appreciated. We want to reach deep in our hearts to wish you the best for a heartfelt happy holiday for you and your family. And this is Frida Fillmore signing off for WBFR in New York City and wishing you and yours a very Merry Christmas. Good night.
Wendy McCord from Lapeer. I played Bert, Mrs. Hatch, Dr. Campbell, and the Sheriff.
I'm Hayden Middlewood from Lapeer. I played young Violet.
Merry Christmas, Bob. Ed Mankowski from Bloomfield Village. I played Ernie.
Hi, I'm Linda Maxville McDonald from Flint. I played the bridge keeper and the cop.
Hello, I'm Ryan Succi from Davison, and I played George Bailey.
Hi, I'm Abigail, and I'm from Lapeer, and I play Mrs. Thompson and the boys.
And I'm Ellen Wara from Metamora, and I play the announcer, Rita Fillmore, Josephine, the superintendent of the Angels, and Nick the bartender. Merry Christmas.
I'm Catherine DeRose, and I played Janie and Hortense.
I am Maylin Laundry from Lapeer, and I play Susan.
I'm Mark Dario from Lapeer, and I play Potter, Martini, and Sam Wayman.
Hi, everybody. I'm Abraham Merrill. I'm from Lapeer, and I play the part of Pete and Young Harry.
Merry Christmas, everyone. I am Brandon Kreener from Metamora. I played Mr. Gower, Uncle Billy, and Mr. Welch.
I'm Jim Bennett from Chicago, and I play Peter, Harry, and Clarence, Guardian Angel Second.
Hi, I'm Laurel Droz from Metamora, and I played Violet.
Hello, I'm Jessica Cummings. I'm from Columbiaville, and I played Rose Bailey and stage manager. Happy holidays.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Bryson from Hadley, and I played Mary. Merry Christmas.